See, when I'm home, everything's cool because, you know, I play basketball at the Y with my dad, you know. And dad's an ultra competitor. I love playing basketball with my dad at the Y, you know. But when I'm not there, my dad gets into pickup games with the retarded kids. And he's such a competitor, you know. He's like, come on, Ralph, box out. You got a rebound. Get your finger out of your nose and your head in the game, goddammit. I'll give you something to troll about. I remember one time I came home because my parents lived near Amish people, and I was playing basketball with this Amish guy, you know, at the elementary school, and it was kind of cool because the guy was like really good, you know, but then he started talking trash. He's like, all right, come on, bring it, yeah, come on right now, come on, heathen, bring it, yeah. This is Sir Hamish's backyard, right here, all right, yeah. Oh, you suck, you suck, you suck like your mother. She gets great bonnet, don't you know? Yeah, come on, heathen. Come on, heathen, you know. And then the guy had, like, I don't know, his boots, I mean, he's like pumped them up. I thought they were like Air Hamishes or something, because he like blocked one of my shots. He's like, get that weak ass shite out of here. This is Sir Hamish's house. All right, yeah, yeah. I went to college to be a football player. Yeah, my dad was a great basketball player. I went to college to be a football player, but I was an offensive lineman when I played football. And one of the main reasons you start playing football is so you can get girls. And when you're an offensive lineman, no girl's really going for that. I mean, I've never seen a girl up in the stands at a game going, oh my God, look, look. Oh, I really want to fuck that left tackle. Ooh. Oh, look at the way his stomach's falling out over his belt. Ooh. I just love the way he's slobbering all over himself. Oh, he can down block. Ooh, I just love a belly button I can shove my whole fist into. Yay. Man, I had like two different types of coaches because my high school coach was a really nice guy. You know, he's like, just do the best you can because I love you and Jesus loves you too. You know, I mean, that was what I had. So everything was happy in high school. I get to college, I didn't have that. My coach in college was like John Wayne with Tourette's, you know. This guy probably swore in his prayers. That's where I learned how to say the F word, you know, because he was like every other word. We'd get the playbook, you know, and we'd have to study a certain play for the night before, you know, the night before. And then we'd get to practice that day. He'd just throw it out. All right, goddammit, this is how it works. You block this fucking guy. You block this fucking guy. You block this fucking guy. You pull around here, hit that fucking guy. We've got little Petsnick prick out here. You know, we got our own little Petsnick prick to block that fucking guy, but he'll fuck it up. He'll fly in, sack the quarterback, then there's going to be some fat fuck in the stands going, come on, line block! Hasn't played a goddamn down since he was in junior high, spilling nachos and beer all over himself, goddammit! Hey, coach, I got to go. I got chemistry class. You got to be shitting me! You're not a chemist, you're a fucking football player! Here, H2O, water, there's your fucking chemistry class for the day. Whatever happened to the goddamn days where you could take some basket weaving and kick some ass? Then, you know, for some reason, like, my sophomore year, we had to have a sexual harassment talk from one of our coaches, you know? Yeah, some girl gets raped and they blame the football players when they should be blaming the frat kids. But anyway, but you know, we're supposed to have a 30-minute sexual harassment discussion, which, you know, is law, but he comes in, his sexual harassment talk was like 20 seconds. You know?
All right, we're supposed to have this goddamn sexual harassment talk. Don't call some girl a slut or slapper in the ass. All right, back to football. Yeah.
Frat guys. Any frat guys in here? All right. I never joined a frat in college because I'm not gay. I don't know, just the thought of some guy named Skip with a sweater wrapped around his neck, you know, shoving a broom handle up my ass while I'm forced to masturbate on a third-story dorm room butt naked. Just a little too much for me at the ages of 18 or 19 to 20, you know. Where's your beanie, Pledge? Oh, yeah.
We're going to go get some Starbucks later. Hey. I'd go with Margot, buy some Birkenstocks, and see the rugby game. Yeah.
Frat guys.
When I was younger, I never wanted to be a comedian. I didn't want to be a football player. I didn't want to be a basketball player. When I was younger, I wanted to be a professional miniature golfer. I still have that dream, you know? He's off the 18th hole. The dreaded windmill. Second year professional, Don Chernagel, Weidenfest, Fest, PMGA Championship. Don's going to have to put it a bit to the left here because someone spilled a slushy on the putting surface over this afternoon. Don's going to have to make this putt in one. If he does make two, we'll be forced to a playoff or rock, paper, scissors if time does not permit. We apologize for the delay of our coverage this afternoon, but it seems a family of 15 held up the 17th hole for quite some time. It's quite a spectacle when the youngest boy decided to urinate in the water hazard. Don getting ready to putt now. Gently cradling the cherry red handle of his putter. Don plays with a light baby blue colored ball. He claims the color soothes him. Some sort of zen thing, I anticipate. Don, a very spiritual man, an intelligent man. Don Schnegel, a very sexy man. If I was a single young lady in the audience tonight, I would have hot, trashy, sweaty, sleazy sex with Don tonight. I hear he's hung like a goat. Strike that, a horse. And here's the putt. Oh, he's got it! Don Chernagel has won the Pillsbury PMGA Classic. His proud family is coming out to join him now, along with his nymphomaniac Victoria's Secret's lingerie model girlfriend. My dream, damn it. And he's been presented with the winnings, a check for $18. And after I, like, became a huge professional miniature golfing star, you know, I'd have my own Reebok commercial, you know. And we'd have to make it all black and white and grainy, you know, all melodramatic. I'd be out there. You know those nights when Dad and I decided to go next to 18th, the old pissing putt? I was tired, man. My wrists were hurting. I said, Dad, I want to get that cherry red slushy and that plate of nachos, man. Dad says, No, son. Let's go an extra 18. One more shot at that dreaded windmill. That's what it's all about, man. That's how you become great. Reebok. Man. I wanted to be a congressman, too, when I was younger, but after the pictures they took for the CD cover, I don't think that'll be happening. You know, I like my photographer. He's a famous photographer, actually. He shoots everybody, but he's kind of fruity. Yeah, but he comes up with some weird ideas, which I'm like, okay, whatever, you're the genius, you know. But he had me on the cover, you know, naked with a jester hat on, which I think is kind of funny. But you just don't get congressman stuff with that, you know. Because he had me in his studio, and he's like, okay, come on, puppy, come on, bitch, give it to me, show me that. Okay, yeah. I was like, all right, man, you know. Then he wanted me to tuck it at one time. I'm like, hey, man, I ain't tucking shit, man. What would John Wayne do? No, none of that, you know. He's like, oh, come on, bitch. So I had like a Silence of Lambs thing going there, like, don't you hurt my dog. I'm sitting there like this, all tucked, going, I'll never be a congressman, you prick. Thanks a lot, you know.